Hello, I'm Dr. David Richardson. I'm a cataract and glaucoma surgeon in Southern California. And during my commute, I like to discuss those topics that there's simply not enough time to discuss in detail during a typical office appointment. So today I'd like to discuss a class of glaucoma treatments. This class is the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor class of medications. And in particular, I'm going to focus on the oral medications today, the ones that are taken by mouth. And at a later time, I will discuss the eye drop or the topical treatment. All right, let's get going. So the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor class has been around for about 3/4 of a century. As such, it is one of the longest available treatments for glaucoma. And it's actually quite an effective glaucoma treatment. It works by reducing the amount of fluid that's produced in the ciliary body. The ciliary body is tissue behind the iris, or the colored part of the eye, that produces fluid that then bathes all of the internal surfaces of the eye, takes nutrients, removes waste products, and then it drains through the trabecular meshwork into the Schlemm's canal and out the collector channel system. Now, open-angle glaucoma is thought to be due to a problem with the trabecular meshwork, or the drainage grate, as it's commonly called among surgeons. Now, this treatment, the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor class, like most of the glaucoma medications, does not work at the trabecular meshwork. It works at the level of the production of fluid. Now, acetazolamide is the main generic version of the oral carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. The other one is methacholamide. Of the two, acetazolamide is generally the one that's prescribed the most because it's more effective. It's generally taken 4 times a day in the generic form, although there is an extended release form that can be taken 2x a day. This is generally preferred among physicians as well as patients, but unfortunately, even though this class of medications has been around for over 70 years, and you would think that because of that it would be inexpensive, over the last few years it's gone from being very affordable to quite unaffordable, and especially the extended release versions. So when would this class of oral medications be prescribed? Well, because of some things I'm going to tell you about in a few moments, this class is generally reserved for those who have very high intraocular pressures, uncontrolled with eye drops, or those who are in what we call the perioperative period, so either anticipating surgery and we need to do something to emergently get their pressures down, or after surgery, if they experience what's called an intraocular pressure spike, which is relatively common after glaucoma surgery. You can have pressures that are too high for a while, too low for a while, and you have to do what you can to get them into the sweet spot. This is a very effective medication for that. But the problem is that it has a number of side effects. Some of these side effects are localized to the eye. So for example, the need to change prescription glasses because of induced myopia, which is becoming more nearsighted. Now this is usually transient. So it starts when you take the medication, tends to get a little better with time, and then it should resolve when the medication is discontinued. The other thing, oddly enough, is that it can actually put someone at risk for developing angle closure. So the angle where the trabecular meshwork is closes off, you end up with a very high pressure, which could lead to sudden loss of vision. Now, the irony, of course, is that we often use Diamox, which is the brand name of acetazolamide, to treat very high pressures, even those from angle closure. So this is an unlikely risk, but it is one that has to be considered. Then there are a number of systemic issues and side effects with this class of medication when taken orally, especially. There can be an odd metallic taste that is experienced, especially common with carbonated beverages, which would be really annoying if you're a Coke fan or Pepsi, depending on which side you're on. There can be some tingling of fingers, frequent urination. Acetazolamide and methacholamide do end up acting as diuretics. And all of those things are pretty annoying, but not life-threatening. there are other things that are a bit more than just annoying. One is gastrointestinal distress. Now, this can range from just upset stomach to cramps, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, which, of course, diarrhea is bad enough. That could be significant in terms of one's health. Now, fortunately, the issue with diarrhea and the gastrointestinal issues tend to be addressed with just taking the medications with food. And as much as possible, I'll try to mention what the ways are to reduce the associated risks. So I just parked in my office parking lot, so I'll try to finish this up now. But there are a number of risks of this particular medication. We've not even gotten to the really important ones. There can be some fatigue, lethargy, depression, even impotence, which is a particular syndrome that's noted with this class of medications. Kidney stones, as a diuretic, this particular diuretic, you're at increased risk of that. The best way to avoid that or to reduce the risk is actually to keep hydrated. And then there are some rare but life-threatening issues. You can have what's called an acidosis, in which case the blood becomes more acidic. If it's mild, it's not a big deal, but more severe acidosis could lead to hospitalization. Hypokalemia, which is a low potassium. This is usually transient, usually just starts with the initiation of the medication and then gets better. For most people, all that needs to be done is improved dietary supplementation. So eating bananas, spinach, broccoli, or sometimes a supplement. Then there are some very serious, but rare, fortunately, potential side effects. One is called Stevens-Johnson syndrome, in which the mucous membranes just start falling apart. And this can be life-threatening and often requires hospitalization and intense medical treatment. And then the other one that is fortunately very, very rare, but definitely life-threatening is what's called aplastic anemia, in which case the body just stops producing blood cells. Now, this can't be detected by laboratory testing. And so generally what's done or what's recommended is just that people are aware of the issues, symptoms of anemia. So trouble breathing, loss of energy, fatigue. Of course, we talked about the other side effects, which are fatigue, loss of energy. So that makes it a little difficult to detect. And then bleeding issues. So for all of these reasons, as you can imagine, this class of medication is not prescribed very frequently, and I've not even gotten to the end. Quickly, you should avoid these medications when already taking the thiazide class of diuretics, when already taking digitalis. There may be some overlap in terms of allergy with those who have an allergy to sulfa medications, although that is, you know, not agreed upon by everyone. So, in summary, as a class, the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors work really well to lower pressure, but when taken orally, come with a long list of side effects that range from annoying to life-threatening. And so for this reason, we really don't prescribe them, except when an individual is at high risk of rapidly losing vision from a very elevated intraocular pressure. There are exceptions to that. I, as well as other ophthalmologists, have patients who are taking these chronically and doing quite well on them. But in general, we do try to avoid them if we can. And so that will then set the stage for my next video, which will be discussing the same class as an eye drop. Essentially what happens with that risk-benefit ratio in the eye drop form. All right, hope you found this informative, and I'll see you again shortly, I hope.